So welcome friends, today we are going to discuss about the most interesting as well as controversial topic in the field of GST, that is intermediary services. Friends, when you talk about this particular topic, intermediary services, please note that this typical word, that is agent or intermediary, has a huge or a substantial checkered history, and that's where we need to understand the concept of agent right from day one when service tax law was introduced, and then we will understand as to how it has evolved over a period of time and what are the present challenges and what are likely to be the future challenges in the context of agent or intermediary services. Friends, when we talk about agent, typically I think all of us will think about these agents, correct? If you are movie lovers. But if you are indirect tax professional, I think for us, agent will typically mean a stockbroker agent, a air travel agent, a steamer agent, a real estate agent, a insurance agent, a C&F agent, a railway agent, correct? Because that is how the agent-related evolution has happened in the positive list regime. You'll be surprised to know, friend, that when service tax was introduced in India on 1st of July 1994, one of the very first agent services which was introduced, the tax was introduced, was stockbroker agent services. So one can say that the term agent is used effectively in the service tax law right from day one. And at the same time, these various agents got added in the field of service tax in the positive list regime, typically you can say till 2003. So that's where almost all the agent got covered. Obviously after that also recovery agent, share transfer agent also got added in 2006. But till 2003, broadly one can say all the agents got covered. Now, why this we need to know? Because when these various agents were getting added, one of the very important term which was used in the service tax law in the positive list regime was commission agent. Now, when this term commission agent was defined in 2003, they had used two important words. They said that typically a commission agent is a person who causes sale, correct? He is causing sale of goods. And at the same time, please note, it was mentioned that the consideration typically which that person is entitled to as commission agent, it is typically decided based on quantum of such sale which he is causing. So typically if a person was getting commission, was getting consideration, maybe based on cost plus methodology, then there was a question whether he will qualify as a commission agent or not in the context of this particular definition. And that's where we need to understand that in the initial days, when the term commission agent was defined, we were told that there are two important things. One, he should cause sale of those goods. And second, his earning should be actually dependent on the quantum of sale. Although this definition is not relevant, but still this particular meaning we need to understand when we are going to discuss about the commission agent or intermediary services in more detail. Friends, after this particular term was defined, on 1st of July 2003, the service category known as business auxiliary services was introduced in the context of service tax law. Here again, the term commission agent or design or defined, and we were told that commission agent means a person here also who is causing sale, and then he is entitled to a consideration, correct? But please note here the quantum of sales, the word was removed, correct? So one can say that any person who is causing sale and he, if he is entitled to receive a consideration, one can say that he can be called as commission agent. Now friends, typically that's where almost all the issues which always revolved around the positive list regime was whether a person is covered under business auxiliary service or not. Because this category or this particular entry was the favorite entry for the service tax authorities, because whenever there was no specific category under which a tax could be levied, always a show cause notice was issued under business auxiliary services. And subsequently in 2006, when business support service was issued, then the favorite category became business support services. So that was about the positive list regime area. So when we talk about the agent, be it an intermediary or agent, typically I think this particular image will tell you what is his role. So there are two important people. One, the supplier of goods, and second, the consumer or customer of those goods. So what this agent does, so basically agent is a person like Mr. Larry in this particular photo. So he's in between these two people, that is the supplier and the consumer. So he's trying to either arrange or facilitate the provision of goods or services between the two people, that is the supplier and the agent. And that's where in a similar manner also you'll be able to understand in the context of GST, the definition is worded. So friends, when we need to understand the intermediary services, not only we need to understand that the term agent got evolved over a period of time, because agent, what activity he is doing and what amount he is getting, these terms got evolved over a period of from 1994. But at the same time, even the concept of export, as to who is the recipient and where the services are used, these terms also got evolved during the era of 1994 till 2005. And why these terms are important? Because when today we are going to discuss about intermediary services, our entire discussion is going to be around the fact that if there is an Indian agent who is working for a foreign company, who is working for a company who is located outside India, and if he is helping that company identify buyers in the country, in the in India, then we need to understand whether the services of this agent who is working in India for the foreign company, for manufacturer, to identify customers for the foreign supplier in India, then whether his services will qualify as export or not. And that's where we need to understand how the concept of export got evolved in the pre-GST era, correct? So friends, when service tax was introduced on 1st of July 1994, that time, if you look at the various provision, you'll be surprised to know that there is no specific provision dealing with export. Rather, for the very first time, on 20th February 1999, a particular notification was issued, notification 2 by 1999, wherein it was said that if a person is providing services, correct? If a person is providing services, and for that particular service, if the payment for such service is made in convertible foreign exchange, then the service tax would be exempted. That means in that time, there was no concept of zero rating. Rather, there was a concept of exemption. So exemption was given if a payment was made in convertible foreign exchange. Now, what issue was being arise, that the foreign person was making payment in foreign convertible foreign exchange, but the Indian person in India, he was receiving money in INR. And that's where by way of notification 6 by 1999, they said that exemption would be available if payment is received in convertible foreign exchange. But at the same time, few of the people, they were receiving the payment in convertible foreign exchange, and then they were repatriating that money outside India. So again, it was clarified that there are two important conditions. One, the payment should be received in convertible foreign exchange. At the same time, the money should not be repatriated back. And that's where till 1999, this concept of, one can say, exemption being given to so when the convertible foreign exchange received was more or less settled. So in the earlier era, that till 1999, one can say the condition was very simple, that convertible foreign exchange, if you receive, then you can be rest assured that tax would not be applicable. But subsequently, on 1st of March 1990, subsequently 6 by 1999, this notification was rescinded and a specific circular was issued. And this circular was 56 by 2003. And in this circular, it was clarified that even if the notification which was exempting services which are wherein the payment is received in convertible foreign exchange, even if that notification is rescinded, still one can continue to say that the services are actually not liable to service tax, because service tax is a destination based consumption tax. So for the very first time in a government circular, these words were used, that is, service tax is destination based consumption tax, correct? But the issue here was that when a foreign agent, when an Indian agent is working for a foreign company and he is promoting the goods and services of the foreign company in India, the practical issue was, where are these services of agent getting consumed? Are they getting consumed when the Indian agent is working for the foreign company? That is, are the services getting consumed outside India, or the services are ultimately getting consumed in India again, because the goods or services will be exported by that particular person again in India? So this issue remained open in 2003. Subsequently, what happened? Subsequently, in 2005, a specific rules were introduced under the service tax era, and these rules were named as Export of Services Rule 2005. And in the Export of Services Rule, there were three categories which were created. And I would say, if you compare the current IGST Act as compared to the IGST Act, these rules were extremely simple. Only three rules were there. One, if the location of immovable property is outside India, you can say that it is actually in relation to, if your service is in relation to immovable property, then you can say it is actually export of services. So the one criteria or proxy rule was, you have to identify what is the location of immovable property. The second criteria was, with respect to certain specified services, whether the performance of that service is in India. For example, repair maintenance services, correct? So you'll have to identify where is the service getting performed. And then there was a residual category, that is the rule 3, subclause 3, wherein the basic criteria was that you need to identify where is the recipient located, correct? So if the recipient of that specified service is located outside India, then you can comfortably say that practically your service is exported. Obviously, receipt of consideration in convertible foreign exchange was also one of the criteria. Now, friends, although rule 3 practically covered, this subclause 3 practically covered a business auxiliary services, that is a commission agent will typically get covered under the recipient based criteria. So when a foreign company is appointing an Indian agent to identify customers in India, typically the Indian agent started taking a position that I am billing to a foreign company who is located outside India. They are making me payment in convertible foreign exchange, and my services, because I am identifying various customers and all, my services are being provided to a foreign company. It can be said that the services are actually used outside India, because the Indian taxpayer was actually looking at immediate use of the services, correct? So in this particular chart, you will be able to understand that how the transaction was happening. The agent or intermediary was working in India to identify Indian customers, correct? And he was paid a consideration by the foreign supplier. And once the Indian customer is identified, the foreign supplier is sending goods to the Indian customers, correct? So at the same time, when this issue was being debated and discussed, and people were taking a stand that as intermediary or agent, I'm exporting services to a foreign company. At the same time, the department started taking a stand that actually the intermediary is providing services to foreign agent, correct? The services which are being provided by intermediary to foreign company is actually, one can say, immediate use of his services. But ultimately, the services will get consumed in India because the goods or services would be provided by the foreign supplier in India. And that's where this issue started getting attention. At the same time, in 2007, there was one Supreme Court judgment, which was a very reported judgment, wherein the Supreme Court specifically mentioned that service tax is a destination-based consumption tax. So you can understand the similar terms which are used in the 2003 circular. Similar terms were also used by the Supreme Court in the context of All India Federation of Tax Practitioners. And the Supreme Court at paragraph 7 said that service tax is a destination-based consumption tax, correct? And service tax is applicable only on services provided within the country. But again, when an agent is providing services to a foreign supplier to identify customers or consumers in India, correct, to whom the foreign supplier can make supply goods, the basic question again remains same as to whom the service are being provided by the Indian agent. Are they being provided outside India, or whether the ultimate consumption is happening in India? And in that context, the matter went before the tribunals, and there were two important judgments by the tribunal, one in the name of Blue Star and another in the name of ABS. In both the matters, the taxpayer won in the tribunal, and the tribunal decided the matter in favor of the taxpayer, saying that when services are being provided by the Indian agent to a person who is located outside India, for example, a company, correct, and he is going to then decide, the foreign company is going to supply the goods or services to the Indian entity, customers, then it was said that typically the Indian agent is providing services. The Indian agent is providing services to a recipient located outside India, and it can be said that the services are getting used outside India. And that's why whether it is Blue Star or ABS, in the tribunal judgment, it was specifically mentioned by the tribunal that these services of the Indian agent will qualify as export of services, correct? However, in both the judgment, the departmental authority had taken a stand that because the goods are going to be sold finally by the foreign supplier to India only, correct, to the Indian customers only, it was contended by the department that the ultimate use of those services will be in India, and that's why it cannot be said that it is actually export of services. Because here again, the department relied on the same observation of the Supreme Court that service tax is a destination-based consumption tax. But the departmental authorities were looking at the ultimate consumption, whereas the taxpayer was looking at the immediate consumption. And that's where the matter kept on going to the tribunal on a regular basis, and almost many judgments were delivered or given in favor of the taxpayer. But suddenly, out of nowhere, I would say, suddenly out of nowhere, a department also issued a clarification. So while department was taking a stand in the tribunal that the services are not export, at the same time, by way of circular 115 on 31st July 2009, the department clarified that in case of business auxiliary services, the recipient is the location is the criteria, and it can be said that the agent has actually provided services to a foreign company who is located outside India, because the benefit is actually arising or accruing to the foreign supplier who is outside India. And that's where it was clarified that these activities of business auxiliary services or agent will qualify practically as export of services. So it was a circular which was in favor of the taxpayer. So similarly worded, I would say, the way the ABS or Blue Star judgments were worded. But surprisingly, what happened that in 2009, after the circular was issued, the matter was before the tribunal, Delhi tribunal, in the case of Microsoft Corporation. Herein also, the Microsoft Corporation was actually identifying customers in India, and then they were billing to their parent entity who was in Singapore, and they were getting a particular commission, one can say. Here again, the issue was same, whether the services are provided outside India, or because the Singapore entity was again supplying the goods to the Indian customer, whether the ultimate use of the services in India only, and that's where the services will not qualify as export of services. Now, in this context, when the matter was before the tribunal, and it was just a stay matter, still through a detailed tribunal order, more than 30 paragraph, the tribunal said that this activity which is being provided, which is being supplied by the this particular Microsoft Corporation, it was said that one can say prima facie, the activity may not qualify as export. So the tribunal relied on the fact that the ultimate consumption of the goods or services will happen in India. So the tribunal is not looking at the immediate use, correct? The tribunal is ignoring the fact that the payment is coming from Singapore entity, Microsoft entity. They are not looking at the immediate use, but they are actually looking at the end use. And that's where the matter became a bit complicated, because the tribunal judgment also mentioned the fact that the CBEC circular, which we just referred, the 2009 circular, circular 115, it said that this particular circular is actually running counter to the ratio of Supreme Court judgment which are delivered by the Supreme Court in the case of All India Federation of Tax Practitioners. And that's where the department also got a negative, comment from the tribunal. And in this particular judgment, though it's a detailed judgment, I would say, and also at the end of the day, the matter went in favor of the taxpayer only in 2014. But still, this particular judgment, I would say, is actually the judgment based on which the concept of intermediary originated in India. Although the concept of intermediary you can trace back to various VAT regime, but in Indian context, the very first judgment, I would say, wherein the term intermediary was regularly used, was this Microsoft 2009 judgment. And in this judgment, again, there was a word facilitated. So I would say that particularly, the two terms, intermediary and facilitation, actually owe their origin to this Microsoft judgment. And that's what happened, friends. After this particular judgment, because this judgment was in favor of the tax authorities, then obviously the industry started to get a panic. And they started to approach the CBEC regularly on this particular issue, that please clarify whether our services as the Indian agent, if we are working for a foreign company who is going to supply goods or services in India, whether our services will qualify as export or not. So when the taxpayer regularly represented before CBEC, again in 2011, CBEC came out with a clarification, wherein the clarification was not happily worded, rather it was vaguely worded, because herein, though CBEC tried their level best, but what they clarified, that used outside India shall be interpreted to mean the benefit of the service should accrue outside India. But in case of agent services, how to determine whether the benefit is accruing outside India, or should we look at the immediate use, or should we look at the end use? That particular point was not clarified. Additionally, they had used the word like effective use and enjoyment. Still, there was substantial amount of clarification which should have been issued, which was missing in this particular clarification. Only one silver lining was that CBIC again clarified, CBEC, I would say, because in those time it was named as CBEC. They clarified again that call center related services, one can continue to claim it as export of services, because in 2009, call center services were one of the most prominent services in India. Now, when all these things were happening, the matter was regularly reaching the doors of the tribunal. On 1st of July 2012, India introduced negative list regime, correct? Now, when the negative list regime was introduced, what the department or the GST authorities, service tax authorities did, they used the word intermediary under the negative list regime, correct? And in the context of intermediary for services, they clarified that the place of supply of intermediary services would be actually location of the service provider. That means if there is a service provider who is an intermediary, correct? If you qualify as an intermediary, then the place of supply, correct, for your services, place of provision of service, as it was called, POPS. So you have the place of provision of service for your particular activity will be your location. So if you are located in India, then the place of supply would be in India. Now, please note that if you wanted to say that I am exporting services to a person who is located outside India, then one of the conditions which was put under the export of services rules, rule 6A, was the place of provision of service should be outside India. But in the context of intermediary service, because the place of provision of service was said to be in India only, practically the people who were qualifying as intermediary, they could not say that they are exporting the services. Now, please note that this term intermediary, when they used under the negative list regime, they had to define this term as to what an intermediary means. Now, you will be able to recall that we just discussed that the term commission agent, agent, these words were used in the positive list regime. So now, instead of referring to those words, correct, instead of defining those words, they said that we are going to use the word intermediary, and we will define what an intermediary means. Now, this term intermediary, they defined in a manner wherein they said intermediary means they are giving an exhaustive definition. They said intermediary means a broker or an agent. So they are using the word broker, because I think you would recall that the word stock broker was used, correct? So they are using the word broker here. Then they said comma an agent, correct? Or any other person. So they said an intermediary can be a broker, agent, or you can call him by any name, correct? Or any other person by whatever name called. But what he should do, who arranges or facilitates provision of a service or supply of goods. So he should arrange, correct, service, or he should arrange supply of goods. But please note that the word arrange and facilitation, these words are not defined under the, they were not defined under the service tax law, and neither they are defined under the GST law. But as we discussed, that the term facilitation, the word facilitation, this word was used in 2009 in the Microsoft judgment. And again, this word, you can find a reference of this word particularly in the definition of intermediary services. So it says, who arranges or facilitates provision of a service or supply of goods between two or more person. So the most important condition is that there should be two people, one the supplier of goods or services, and second the recipient or customer of goods or services. And intermediary's role is actually to arrange or facilitate provision of service between those two people, correct? But at the same time, there was an exclusion which was provided from the definition of intermediary, and the exclusion read as, but does not include a person who provides main service or supplies the goods on his own account. So when somebody is supplying the goods, or when somebody is supplying the services on his own account, correct? In such cases, it can be said that he will not qualify as an intermediary person. And if he is not an intermediary person, then one can say that his services can be said to be exported if he fulfills all the condition. But at the same time, it becomes a matter of debate how to determine or how to define whether a person is providing services or supplying goods on his own account, or whether he is working as an agent. In this context, in the education guide, which was issued on 20th of June 2012, in the education guide in the era of service tax, it was clarified that by way of example, that who is a person who is providing services on his own account. So they gave an example, and a very beautiful and relevant example. They talked about freight forwarders. Now, who is a freight forwarder? Typically, freight forwarders are typically located in large towns where there is a port. And this freight forwarder, what they do? They buy space on a particular, they buy berth or space on a particular shipping line or on a ship or vessel. And then they sell that particular space to third party customers in India. So let us take an example that a person named as Mr. Say ABC, who is located in Mumbai, he buys a berthing space, or he is buying a shipping space, a particular, like say 100 container space on a particular vessel for $10 each. And then he goes to a company, another company, let's say Godrej, and he tells them that would you like to buy this particular space because this vessel is going to go from Mumbai to USA on this particular date. If you'd like to export your goods, you can buy this per container space from me for $12. So what is happening? This person is independently selling the space. So he's a person who is buying space and he's selling space. So one can say that this person who is buying space and selling space, this person is working on his own account, because if he's able to sell at $12, he'll be able to earn profit. But at the same time, if he's unable to find the buyers, like say right now there's a corona. So because of this kind of challenges, if he's unable to sell the spaces, then he will have to sell it much cheaper, like say $5 or $6. In such cases, he will incur losses. So it was clarified that when a person is working on his own account, then he cannot be called as an agent. He will not qualify as intermediary services. And accordingly, one can say that tax will not be applicable. But at the same time, it was also clarified that if somebody is working as an agent, then tax will become applicable. So if Pritam Maure is working as an agent of a particular vessel company, and the same space, the shipping space or space which is there on the vessel, if I'm selling it to another company like Godrej and I get 10% commission from the shipping line, then it was clarified that I am working as an agent of the shipping line and my activity will qualify as intermediary and I'll be required to pay service tax on the activity, and it cannot be said that I'm actually exporting the services, correct? And that's where, friends, this entire issue then boiled down to the fact that are you providing services on your own account or are you providing services on principal to principal basis? And in that context, if you actually look at in the era of service tax, there are quite a few judgment also, and the prominent being the, rather than judgment, I would say advance ruling also, the prominent two advance ruling being GoDaddy India and Universal Services. Friend, in the era of service tax, the advance ruling were quite respected because of the fact that the advance ruling authority, the composition of the advance ruling authority, in that particular composition, there was always used to be a retired judge. And that's where you will find that these advance ruling which are given in the service tax era, they are quite detailed. And in this one of the detailed advance ruling in the case of GoDaddy, it was clarified that the person was working on a principal to principal basis. So although the company GoDaddy was actually marketing and they were doing the offline marketing, online marketing for their parent company, correct? And they were getting certain amount. But because the GoDaddy company in India was working on principal to principal basis, it was said that this person, that is GoDaddy, will not qualify as intermediary. And practically, then one can say that the services provided by this GoDaddy India can be claimed as export of services. So that's what this particular advance ruling talked about. Additionally, similar understanding was also given under the Universal Services case. Now, these cases or advance ruling clarified us that the meaning of on his own account is going to be debated word, because typically, even in case of agency, you can find certain clauses in the agreement wherein the clauses will read as that person will not, that person who, to whom you are appointing to do work, he will not work as agent, but rather he will work on principal to principal basis. So in many contracts, this kind of terminology used. Now, if these terms are used, then can one say that even agent will not qualify as intermediary? That is a big question which we'll have to answer. And we are going to discuss about that, but maybe in the subsequent slide. So friends, when in 2012, service tax era said that intermediary is liable to service tax, but they only talked about intermediary for services. Subsequently, on 1st of October 2014, they added intermediary for goods also. But please note, they did not add intermediary for securities. This term intermediary for securities was added subsequently in the GST era. And we are going to talk about it, but in the subsequent slide. Now, friend, what happened? We started our discussion with introduction of service tax on business auxiliary services in 2003. Then we said that in 2005, export of services rules were introduced. Then we said that in 2009, there were quite a few important judgments, including Microsoft, ABS, Blue Star, correct? Then in 2012, we said that negative list regime was introduced. Then in 2014, this intermediary for goods were also included, correct? So we have traveled from 2003 practically, or 1999 to practically 2014. Now what happened that after that also there were many developments, like say the Microsoft judgment, which we talked about in 2009, which was delivered, which was a stay order and which went against the taxpayer. Practically, this matter was decided in favor of the taxpayer in 2014. So finally it was said that Microsoft is actually exporting services. Correct? Microsoft, although they are working for the foreign company, correct, to promote the foreign companies' goods in India, still it was said that we need to look at the recipient location and who is the recipient, the person who is making payment. And because Microsoft Singapore is making payment to Microsoft India, it was said that this person who is doing these services, that Indian company for outside entity, his activity, sorry, will qualify as export of services. But right now, please note that this matter, although determined or decided in favor of the taxpayer, right now this matter is pending before the Supreme Court. Additionally, there were many high court judgments also, for example, AGS India, MIEX India, and the series of judgments continued. But while the judgments continued, in 2017, on 1st of July 2017, we introduced GST in India, correct? So I hope, friends, till now we discussed about the service tax era, the positive list regime, the negative list regime, and the various judgment. Now, this basic understanding of the various issues and why this term intermediary is going to get debated, I hope that this will provide you enough clarity when we are going to discuss the term intermediary in the context of GST law. Now, friends, as we said that on 1st of July 2017, we introduced GST law in the country. Now, when you look at the GST law, you'll be able to understand that typically if the transaction is intrastate, CGST and AGST is applicable. If the transaction is interstate, IGST is applicable. Now, in the context of intermediary services, again, at Section 13, Subclause 8, it was clarified, similar to the POPSR rule, it was clarified that the place of supply, the place of supply of intermediary services will be location of intermediary. That means if an agent, that is an intermediary, is working in India, correct, for a foreign company, for a foreign manufacturer, correct, then in such cases, the location of supply would be location of supplier. That means practically GST would be payable. Now, please note, and I think all of you would be aware also, that the export of services conditions which are there under Section 2 Subclause 6 of IGST Act, they are replica of the erstwhile export of services rules, Rule 6A, wherein under the earlier rules also it was a condition that the place of provision of service should be outside India. But as we discussed, that the place of supply of intermediary services is always going to be in India. So one cannot say, one cannot take a position as far as the rules are concerned, unless and until you challenge the act, you cannot take a position that your services are actually qualifying as export of services. So friends, now we come to Section 2 Subclause 13, wherein the word intermediary is defined. Now, if you compare the intermediary word, which is defined, intermediary term, which is defined under the GST law, you'll be able to understand that almost it is copy-paste of the service tax era definition, correct? So if you understood the intermediary definition, which we just discussed when we are discussing the service tax era related part, you'll be able to understand that the definition is exactly same. Correct? So you don't have to again go through the definition, but still for the benefit of all, we'll just quickly glance through the definition. What it says, intermediary means a broker, agent, or any other person by whatever name called, who arranges or facilitates supply of goods or services, or both, or securities. As we discussed, that the word or both or security, these are the new addition as compared to the service tax era, between two or more person. Here again, two people are important, the main supplier and the end consumer, correct? But does not include a person who supplies such goods or services or both on his own account. So here again, they are saying the same thing, that if somebody is supplying goods or services on his own account, then he cannot qualify as an intermediary. But friends, please note that in the era of service tax, the term agent or broker, these terms you are not defined. But in the era of GST, please note, the term agent is defined under the CGST Act. If you look at Section 2 Subclause 5, the term agent is defined in a manner that agent means broker. That means practically you can say both the term which are used under the intermediary definition, that is agent as well as broker, both the terms are defined, because the Section 2 Subclause 5 of CGST Act reads as agent means. So again, here an exhaustive definition they are talking about. Agent means a person including factor, broker, commission agent. So again, here they are using the word commission agent. As we discussed, typically the commission agent word was used in the era of positive list regime in 2003. And after that, again, it was used in 2005 again in the definition of business auxiliary services. So here again, they are using the word commission agent. RTA, Dale Crader agent, auctioneer, or any other mercantile agent by whatever name called. So whatever name you give, but they are saying who carries on the business of supply or receipt of goods or services or both on behalf of another. That means, again, as an agent, you need to work on somebody else's behalf. If you are working on your own, practically you cannot qualify as agent. And that's where, friend, and you, whenever there's an issue, whether somebody is working as an intermediary or not, the entire matter, I think almost every time, it is going to boil down to the fact, are you working on your own behalf, correct? Or you are working on somebody else's behalf? If you work on your own account, you cannot qualify as intermediary. If you are going to work on behalf of someone else, you can qualify as an intermediary. Now, what is going to be the meaning of the term on behalf of another, on his own account? For that, as we discussed, that you can refer to the earlier advance ruling in the context of service tax law, which are given in the name of GoDaddy and Universal, which we have reproduced earlier. Now, friends, because GST law used these terms intermediary, practically many of the taxpayer got confused that whether my services are going to be liable in the GST regime or not. Am I qualifying as intermediary or not? And that's where many of the taxpayers in the GST era started approaching the advance ruling authority. And that's where you have plethora of advance ruling on intermediary services, wherein some of the taxpayers, for example, Infiera and Asahi, their activity was actually market research, and they used to follow with the leads for the parent company or outside entity. So they approached to the advance ruling authority saying whether our activity will qualify as intermediary services or not. And they had an expectation that based on the GoDaddy and Universal judgment, they will get a positive ruling. But unfortunately, as all of you are aware, that instead of advance ruling, many people call it adverse ruling authority. So they also got an adverse ruling in the case of Infiera and Asahi Kasai. Similarly, another applicant, who went to the advance ruling authority for asking whether their marketing support, demonstration support services, whether it will qualify as intermediary or not. So in the case, in the name of McAfee software and ANSI software, if you go through, you'll be able to realize that here again, the advance ruling authority, including the appellate advance ruling authority, clarified that these activities practically will qualify as intermediary services. Then somebody named as Five Star Shipping, they were a chartering agent. They also went before the advance ruling authority asking whether their activity will qualify as intermediary services or not. Again, they got a ruling wherein it was said that they will qualify as intermediary services. Similarly, somebody who was a sole agent and the name of the entity was Foam Aluminium, they also went before the advance ruling authority and they were told that their activity will qualify as intermediary services. Similarly, Sabre Travel, Global Reach Education, their actual activity was marketing and promotion, and they approached the advance ruling authority and they got a clarification again that they are actually intermediary. Even VServe Global, who was actually carrying out the activity of back office services, even when they approached advance ruling authority, they were told that their activity actually qualifies as the intermediary services. So that's where you can understand, friend, almost whatever is the nature or almost all the nature of various services which the taxpayer was doing in India for their parent company or outside India entity, it was clarified that their activity will qualify as intermediary services. Although almost in all the cases the taxpayer got a negative ruling, there are few ruling wherein the advance ruling authority clarified that these activities are not qualifying as intermediary. So for example, somebody known as Fulcrum Info, they were carrying out the activity of export import compliances admin support for a foreign company, and they sought advance ruling that whether our activities qualify as intermediary or not. Fortunately, the advance ruling authorities told them that you don't qualify as intermediary. Similarly, someone named as Sri Thomas, he approached the advance ruling authority that I am doing management consultancy, whether my activity will qualify as intermediary or not. So friend, surprisingly, that management consultancy typically will not get covered, but he approached, correct? And fortunately, I think his luck was on his side. He got an advance ruling that management consultancy services will not qualify as a intermediary services. So you can find that almost in all the cases, taxpayer got advance ruling saying that their activity will qualify as intermediary services, but there are few handful ruling wherein it was said that their activity will not qualify as a intermediary services. Now, as we discussed that there are advance ruling in the context of GST, but at the same time, as we discussed that there are many advance ruling in the context of service tax also, and also there are many detailed judgment in the context of service tax. So the naturally question which will come to your mind is, should we refer to service tax cases or not? The practical answer for that is basically, yes, you should refer. Although on this particular point, the advance ruling authorities are divided. In case of Infiera, it was said that there is no difference between the term intermediary in the GST regime and pre-GST era. So one can refer to both the definition. But in case of global reach, it was said that the definition of intermediary are not same. So actually, they should not be referred to. But we have seen that typically, we have seen practically that both the definitions are exactly replica of each other, the intermediary definition, except few words, which are actually in the context of GST only. In case of McPhee also, there was a particular reference or mention which was there by the advance ruling authority saying that the judgment related to service tax era have no applicability in GST regime. Practically, we do not agree with this particular view, because when you look at the service tax era, and as we discussed, the definitions are pretty much similar, correct? And the principles which have actually evolved in the service tax era can certainly be referred to. So that's where our answer is, yes, you can refer to the various judgments which are there under the old service tax law. Friends, now what is happening that because the term intermediary has been defined in a very loose or very vague manner, because any person who arranges or facilitates a supply of goods or services between two or more person. So the term arrangement is not defined, the term facilitation is not defined. Practically what is happening that this term intermediary is creating challenge for almost all the taxpayer. There are few taxpayer who are call center, who are doing, somebody is doing market research, somebody is doing back office work, somebody is doing accounting, somebody is providing ITS service. But because of the challenges which have crept in the GST law, thanks to the advance ruling authority, now almost all the taxpayers right now are confused about as to whether my activity will qualify as intermediary or not. Because the impact is that if you qualify as intermediary, practically you will be liable to make payment of 18% GST on your income. Now please note that many entities who are working as back office and ITS entity, their business margin, when they are working with for a foreign company, their business margin is now shrunk to just 3-5%, because they are competing with all the Vietnamese company, Philippine companies and all, because many call centers and all, they have opened up in various other parts of the world. Correct? Earlier in 2005 to 2010, almost India was leading entity when it came to call center, back office and ITS services. But because we are getting regular competition, the margins are shrinking on a regular basis. But at the same time, while the margins are shrinking, there's a huge threat almost which is there on the heads of all the taxpayer who are providing services to a customer or recipient located outside India, because they are worried about the fact whether their services will qualify as intermediary or not, because they are just earning 5-7% income net margin. And if GST is said to be applicable 18%, they will have to literally close down their shops. And that's where, friends, this particular issue needs to be clarified by the CBIC at earliest in days to come. While one particular circular was issued, we will discuss about that, but this circular was subsequently withdrawn. And that's where we are a bit worried right now as to what is the stand which CBIC is going to take on this particular matter. And that's where let us now take our discussion to the next level. Friends, as we discussed that this particular term intermediary has created many challenges, correct? So let's try to simply understand what is the final outcome as to who is going to pay GST and who is not going to pay, if somebody is qualifying as an intermediary or not, correct? So let's understand. First, let's take a simple scenario that the supplier is in India, the end consumer is in India, and intermediary is also in India. So everybody is in India, correct? And if the intermediary turnover is above threshold, he will have to pay GST. There is no question about it. Extremely simple question, correct? Case number one. Case number two, the supplier, correct? He's a foreign supplier. He's outside India, but the customer is in India, and the Indian intermediary, he is identifying all the customers and he's connecting the Indian customers with the foreign entity. Now tell me, will this activity in the case two will qualify as intermediary or not? I think based on the discussion which we had today, correct, all of you will agree that this activity particularly will get qualified as an intermediary if that person is working on say a particular percentage commission basis and he is working not on he is working on behalf of the other entity. He is not working on his own. So if that is the case, one can say that under serial number two, that is case two, the activity will qualify as a intermediary services. Now let's understand case three. When you look at case three, the terminology or the facts are that the supplier is located outside India. The customer is also located outside India, but the Indian agent, correct, he is located in India. So let us take example. There is a supplier in USA and there is a customer in Canada. And what this Indian intermediary is doing, he's connecting both of them. Correct? So in this context, recently the government, so in this context, again, the issue was whether the Indian intermediary will charge GST. And if he's charging GST, practically nobody is going to take his services. Correct? So that's where the government issued a notification under IGST law by way of 20/2019, wherein a specific exemption is given, wherein it is said that no tax or GST would be applicable if the supplier is outside India and the customer is outside India. But please note that there are 5 conditions which you'll have to fulfill. And this exemption is only given to intermediary for goods. So this particular important point you need to keep in mind with respect to case study 3. Case study 4, if everybody is outside India, practically there is no issue or question about GST being applicable, correct? Supplier is outside India, customer is outside India, and intermediary is also outside India, no GST applicable. So serial number 1, wherein we say everybody is India, GST applicable. So contrary example is serial number 4, wherein everybody is outside India, not to be discussed. Serial number 5 is now interesting. Please note that supplier is that he is an Indian supplier. He is an Indian manufacturer. He wants to identify that whether somebody would like to buy the product which I am manufacturing in India. So let's take, there is an Indian manufacturer who is manufacturing gloves and surgical equipments. He wants to identify whether somebody in USA is requiring these products or not because of corona crisis, correct? So he approaches an intermediary or agent who is in USA and he says that, can you please find the customers in USA for me? And if you identify a customer, I will pay you 2%, 5%, whatever is your commission, correct? So the Indian manufacturer is appointing a foreign agent who will identify customers, correct, in say USA. Now in such cases, the question is whether GST is to be payable. Now please note that the Indian company is making payment outside India. So it is expenditure for the Indian company, correct? So the issue here is not about income, it is about expenditure. And in the context of expenditure, as all of you are aware, that typically reverse charge mechanism provision, you will have to see that whether under reverse charge mechanism, you will have to make payment of GST on this particular payment which you are making to a foreign agent. Now in this context, please note that as far as import of service is concerned, if you refer to section 2 of IGST Act, there's a specific definition which is given for import of services, I think under subclause 11, where it is said that for import of services, to qualify as import of services, the place of supply should be in India. Now, as we discussed under section 13 subclause 8, the place of services of intermediary services is location of supplier. And because the agent in the example serial number 5 is located outside India, one can say that under reverse charge mechanism, the Indian entity will not be liable to make payment of GST. But friends, please note that if you look at the notification which is issued for reverse charge mechanism, the term import of service is not used. And that's where there's a huge confusion around this particular fact, that whether under serial number 5 reverse charge will trigger or not. In our view, it should not trigger, but still we are aware about the fact that there is an anomaly in the notification, and that's where many people have this particular doubt. This notification which we referred under the case number 3, this is the notification that is 20/2019, wherein as we mentioned that there are 5 conditions which a particular person has to fulfill if he wants to say that no tax is payable on the intermediary services which he is going to provide to a customer who is located outside India, and even the customer's customer, correct, if he is also located outside India. Now friends, with this we are almost through with our discussion on the term intermediary. Now friends, we would like to raise certain fundamental questions with respect to intermediary services, and these fundamental questions are not dealing practically with the GST Act, but rather the fundamental question is relating to the constitutional provision. If you look at the fact that in the Constitution of India, typically whenever you are exporting something, for example, under the customs law, if there is export duty to be levied under the serial number 1, that is list number 1, if you look at the constitutional provision under list number 1, there is a specific mention about the fact duties of custom including export duties, correct? So whenever the government wanted to tax something specifically, the power is actually sourced from the Constitution of India. But when it comes to intermediary services, correct? If you look at Article 269A, if you look at Article 246A, there is no specific mention about the fact that when a intermediary, when a person is providing services from India and the recipient is located outside India, then in such cases, correct? Typically, this is the export transaction, that in such cases, IGST or CGST and SGST would be applicable. Because if you look at Article 269A, there is a specific mention about the fact that when the transaction is in the course of import, they are talking about the fact that IGST would be applicable, correct? So in case of import, it is clarified, but it is not clarified in the context of export. And that's where, because of this deeming fiction, people are in the days to come, they will certainly raise a question about applicability of IGST when you are providing services to a person outside India, even if you are not receiving any consideration in India, correct? Because there is no power which is mentioned in the Constitution of India. Because, friends, please note that GST is applicable on supply, but it can be said that supply also will mean that supply should happen in India. If the supply is happening from India but consumed outside India, can it be said that the consumption is happening outside India? And because of that, the GST Act, correct, will not be applicable. Because at the end of the day, as far as Article 245 is concerned, it talks about only extent of laws wherein the laws can be made only for India, correct? Even if you look at IGST Act, it is only applicable for India only. It is not going beyond that. And that's where we need to understand this particular challenge, that in days to come, many people, based on the constitutional provision, will certainly raise question about the fact whether the government has power to levy IGST on export of services or not. Friends, some of you might also would like to refer the GVK industry judgment as well as All India Federation of Tax Practitioner judgment. In case of GVK, it was specifically mentioned that the sites of tax would be where the taxable event occurs. Now, in case of income tax, typically there are two principles. One, the residency principle and source principle, correct? But in the context of GST or indirect taxes, there is only one principle, that is consumption. So if the consumption is happening outside India, practically the situs to levy tax may not even arise. And that's where this particular point, that whether the government has power to levy IGST on transactions which are going to get concluded outside India, is or not, that is certainly going to be tested in the court of law. Although whenever it comes to the constitutional power, whenever it comes to the power of the central and state government to levy taxes, the court has given a liberal interpretation. Even in the case of earlier CIL tax law, VAT law, service tax law, whenever somebody challenge on the basis of power, whether government has power or not, almost all the judgments or many of the judgments were always in the favor of the government. So that's where the likeliness of government winning is much higher. But at the same time, because of the missing deeming fiction, I think this particular challenge is going to remain. And this particular argument, whether the government has power to levy IGST on export activity, whether it is export of goods or services, is going to be tested in the court of law in years to come. So friends, with this, we are almost through with our discussion on intermediary. As we mentioned about the intermediary services, that a particular circular was also issued by the government, because there is so much confusion on the intermediary services. So the government in the GST era in 2019, they issued a circular named as 107, wherein they specifically clarified about applicability of GST with respect to ITES services, wherein they created three scenarios. And the most important scenario in that entire three scenario was with respect to ITES services. In the context of ITS services, they specifically said that ITS services will qualify as export. Correct? They said that it will not qualify as intermediary. So it was a beneficial circular which was issued for the benefit of the taxpayer in India. However, there were certain paras of the circular which were contested, or wherein certain clarification was asked by the taxpayer. And that's where this circular got riddled in controversy. And that's where subsequently this circular was withdrawn by the government. And the GST Council in its 37th meeting said that we will issue appropriate circular subsequently. But it's been around a year, we are still awaiting an appropriate circular on this issue. So friend, it's much surprising that when ITS services actually are one of the backbone for the Indian industry, export industry, it's very surprising that how the government or GST Council can sit and await or make the taxpayer await for such kind of an important clarification. First, they issue a circular, subsequently they withdraw a circular telling us that they will issue a final circular, and still it's been 1 year, still the circular is not issued. So certainly it's a cause of concern for the Indian taxpayer, because if subsequently, maybe 1 or 2 years later, the department takes a view that GST is applicable on ITS services, many of the taxpayers are going to face numerous challenges because they currently, as we discussed, their margins is not more than 3 to 5 or 7%. So making payment, asking them to make payment of GST of 18% is not going to work out for them. Anyways, many of them are going to close their shops because of Corona. I think even because of intermediary services, many people will close their shops in the years to come. And that's where we hope that appropriate circular should be issued in the coming weeks or months. So friends, as we discussed that the term intermediary agent, export of services by Indian agent to a foreign principal, it has been debated since ages. As we said that the discussion started in 2008, wherein the judgments were given in favor of the taxpayer. In 2009 also the judgment were in favor. Subsequently also in 2014, 15, 18, 19, almost all the matters went in favor of the taxpayer, including the Paul Merchant famous case, correct? But right now, almost all the cases which were decided by the tribunal in favor of the taxpayer, and all these are service tax matters, all these matters which were decided are in favor of taxpayer, they are right now pending before the Supreme Courts. So certainly I think the final word would be delivered on the intermediary services by the Supreme Court itself, because although in the case of Microsoft, as we discussed, the matter was given or decided in favor of the taxpayer, but still in days to come, the Supreme Court, whenever they are going to discuss, again, they will clarify, the Supreme Court will clarify about what is going to be the meaning of the term used, as to when can you say the services are actually used outside India. Additionally, Supreme Court will also or is expected to clarify on what is going to be the meaning of the term on behalf of, when can you say that you are working as agent or not. So certainly, friends, the issue with respect to intermediary services, that even if we keep on discussing the basic issue as to how this entire intermediary term or agent term is going to shape up, will be finally decided by the apex court in years or days to come. And that's where we hope or we believe that this particular term is certainly going to be tested in the court of law in years to come. And the controversy is not going to end very soon. So friends, with this, we are through with our session on intermediary services. We hope you like the session and the discussion. We tried our level best to share with you our view on intermediary services. But if there are any questions which are unanswered, please feel free to write the questions or your issues which you'd like a clarity on in the comment box. And with this, we thank you all for joining us for the day. So thanks. See you soon in the next webinar.